Number 59. loving God, as we gather on this Memorial Day and Pentecost Sunday, we are once again reminded of the importance of community. As we recall those whom we lost this past year, we are grateful for the support of this community as it shares with us our grief and celebrates with us the beauty of the life that once lived among us. As we honor the men and women who died in service of their country, we are grateful for this community and the many like it that hold before us a vision of a world where such a sacrifice is no longer needed. And as we retell the story of Pentecost, we are reminded that communities such as this one can be the fertile soil of change for that world of which we dream. And so we ask your blessing of your love and presence among us this morning. Amen. Will you join me now for the responsive reading? In the struggles we choose for ourselves and the ways we move sons and daughters will proclaim my message. Your young men will see visions, and your old men will have dreams. Yes, even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will proclaim my message. I will perform miracles in the sky above and wonders on the earth below. There will be blood, fire, and thick smoke. The sun will be darkened and the moon will turn red as blood before the great and glorious day of the Lord comes. And then whoever calls out to the Lord for help will be saved. Our morning prayer is an adaptation of a prayer of commemoration for the fallen from the Church of England. God of peace, on this Memorial Day Sunday, we ask your loving presence as we remember all those who have passed away and commemorate those who lost their lives in war. And especially on this day, we ask that your love surround those who have suffered during war, those who return scarred, wounded, and disillusioned. Those who waited anxiously at home, those who mourned, and those communities that were diminished and suffered loss. Remember, too, those who acted with kindly compassion, those who bravely risked their own life for their comrades, and those who in the aftermath of war worked tirelessly for a more peaceful world. And as you remember them, remember us, O Lord. Give us a hunger for the day when all people everywhere live with hope, mercy, and true peace. Amen. In 1492, Columbus sailed the ocean blue. It was also a big year for Antonio de Nebraya, who in that year, according to Isaac Fagetus in his article, Unconverted Difference, presented to Queen Isabella his latest book, a textbook on the grammar the Spanish language. Now, for those of us who made it through high school foreign language class by the skin of our teeth, we can consider Nebraya as the father of our troubles, because this book was the first of its kind. Not only the first textbook on Spanish grammar as it was spoken by ordinary folk, but also the first in Europe. No other European country had a textbook for their common language. Because who cared if the farmers knew proper grammar? I doubt that many of them could even read. So you might be wondering whether Nebraya was just a man with too much time on his hands. And apparently Queen Isabella was stunned too, because the bishop had to explain the significance of this little book. Your Highness, he might have reminded her, you want more than anything to conquer the world, because apparently she did. And all of these people you want to conquer we shouldn't be surprised that a sound like the rush of a violent wind filled the house, or that divided tongues of fire appeared among the disciples. The author is drawing on his tradition to help interpret the significance of the post-Easter Christ. And then what happened? This group of Galileans, who presumably all spoke the same language, no male nor female, for you are all one in the Spirit. Patterson points out that this ancient creed is a statement of conviction of the Jesus people. It is not a statement about God or about the mysteries of Christ. It is about people and who they are really. In baptism, they were committed to giving up old identities falsely acquired on the basis of baseless assumptions. Jew or Greek, slave or free, male or female, and declared themselves to be children of God. Which seemed to be the homogenizing drive of empire and the opposite of Pentecost. However, I don't think that this creed is in opposition to Pentecost. I think it lays the foundation. It is not the genuine differences that divide our nation and our world. It's the baseless assumptions that we make about those differences. And oh, how the current political theater is thriving on those baseless assumptions. And how readily so many people in our society accept those assumptions as true. As Diana Butler Bass writes, it is our baseless assumption that have made all the sorrows of human history so unbearable. The Holocaust was allowed to happen because of baseless assumptions. Slavery was possible and continues to be possible because of baseless assumptions. The native peoples and cultures of this continent were driven to the brink of extinction because of baseless assumptions. And those baseless assumptions about the relative worth and worthlessness of people are still alive and well in the minds of too many. And so we need this Pentecost Sunday. We need this invitation to be baptized by the Spirit and to be baptized by fire that burns away our assumptions and our divisions and calls us to reclaim our common humanity and our common inheritance as God's beloved. Of course, we can't expect to suddenly and easily speak a multitude of languages. This baptism by the Spirit and the fire requires a commitment and courage on our part. It takes great courage to see God's face in the face of another. But it takes even greater courage to see our own. To see our own faith and even those people with whom we feel the most at odds. Those people who are politically, theologically, and morally opposed to everything we believe to be true. Once upon a time, we lived in the far west suburbs of Chicago, when there were still large open fields. And periodically, there would be controlled burns to reduce the non-native invasive vegetation and leave fresh space for the native plant to grow. This is the cleansing effect of fire. Baptism by fire discards the invasive assumption, leaving space for the innate uniqueness of each of us to grow. After all, I should not have to give up the beauty of my unique being just because of assumptions that cause some people